Hello, I'm Dave Kites, president of the Otto Wood Shop in Ocala, Florida. We're going to make a video this evening to show the use of the drum sander. It's a piece of equipment in our shop that we have a lot of difficulties with because it's easily abused. It looks like a big sturdy machine, but you really got to be gentle with it. People will run finished wood through there with paint on it, or shellac or varnish, or trying to get rid of that old finish from that piece of furniture that you broke down. This is not the machine. That will blind the sandpaper. This is like sanding on steroids. This drum really goes fast. It heats up the wood. It melts those finishes. They blind the sandpaper. You're done. And not only are you done, but then everybody's done until we change the belt again. So it's not a good idea. So that's why we don't want to run those things through here. Soft, pitchy wood also does the same thing. That pitch heats up under the friction of the sanding, blinds the paper. Got to change the paper. Changing the paper is a pain in the patoot. They haven't developed, for me, a satisfactory way to change the paper yet. It's awkward, and it takes significant time to change. We buy our belts in bulk, but still, cutting our own lengths and putting the taper on the end like you have to still costs us about $6 to change the belt. So we don't want to change it every day. So those are the reasons that we want to be careful about what we run through here in the first place. Now it does a great job of leveling out uneven, big, wide surfaces. It's called a 1632 because you can run 16 inches wide through there in one pass, turn it around and run the other half through, and you get 32 inches. However, seldom do they line up. So it's a little tricky because they don't overlap if you've got a full 32. Now, if you're under that, you can play with it carefully and maybe you can get them to line up. It will take off a significant amount of wood at a pass, but we don't really want to do that. We want to get it even and a decent finish. Now we only put 80 grit paper in ours because if we put finer paper in there, it gets blinded within a day or two or three uses, and it's blinded, so you have to change it again. So we just put 80 in our machine. If it gets too, if you try to take too much off at once, this model here will slow itself down, and this little red light will come on over here by the speed control. And that means that you've cranked this thing down too far, you're trying to take too much wood off at once. If you lighten it up when you see the light on, that means now your board is thinner on one end than the other. So if you bring it back and you run it through the same way, be aware of that, because if you adjust it then for the front end, it's going to be too much again for the back end. Okay, so now let's talk about how you use the sander. Just a piece of wood here. This part right here controls the speed of the belt. The belt moves under the rotating drum, and this turns the whole mess on. In our shop, we also have interlocked this thing with our big dust collection system. That's what this is for, and it won't run at all unless you turn the dust collection on first. And when you do that, then you want to remember to open the slide gate here. If you don't, the sawdust just comes out here all over the place, and you have a big job to vacuum it. So remember to open the gate. Under here is the drum, and it spins in this direction, and the belt runs the wood against it, and it's adjustable up and down. This part moves up and down to change the gap here under the drum between the belt and the drum. This is the handle that makes it go up and down. It's marked down goes this way, up goes this way. So, let's assume we had turned on the vacuum and this thing was ready to run. There's two ways, and I prefer the static way. What I mean by that is, without it running, I put my wood under there and I crank this down slowly so it gets sticky and it's hard to slide it. Now I can't slide it at all. So I go back up here. Now there's a good place to start. Maybe up a little higher. You want to be able to stick the wood in, but have it sticky. That'd be a good place to start. Now other people turn this thing on, have it up high. They know it's up higher than their wood because they did a static check first. And then they just lower it down slowly until it just starts sanding, and then they let go of the wood and it goes on through. I don't know one way is better than the other. So, oops. So we go way up here. So we would turn it on, then lower it down slowly till it starts taking the wood away, then we know where we're at. So it goes through. Then you come back and you make some more passes. But now, to get it going, in our shop, turn on the blower first, the vacuum system, open the gate, and then this switch turns on the drum. And what we did tonight, we jumpered out the back system because it makes so much noise you wouldn't be able to hear us talk. But that's turns on the sander, and then this turns on the bellows. Now we're getting sawdust all over the place. That's what happens if you turn on the blower and don't open the gate, you get the same result. And you're going to have a lot of dust by the time you get done. So when you see that dust, remember, oh yeah, I forgot, I'm not sucking it away. So here, this used to look like that. We sanded off a small amount. It gives a pretty nice finish, even with the 80 grit paper. You can hand sand this from here, and get, and you're ready to finish. Glued up assemblies like chess boards or cutting boards where you've glued together a whole bunch of pieces and you've got all these glue joints in there. If you've done a good job, there'll be very thin glue joints. And you might get away with running it through here. And that's what a lot of people use this for, is because when they glue them up, of course, they never come out even. Personally, when I make them, I run them through the planer unless they're too big. The planer will only handle 15 inches. So if you made one bigger than 15, you can't use the planer. We over here is where we do our hand sanding. We've got a whole bunch of hand sanders, but as most of you guys can appreciate, doing it by hand, it'll be like this. This guy, it'll be flat. And that's why they invented this machine. So you saw it go through. When you bring it back around, I always rotate the piece around for the next pass, and you do not lower it anymore for the next pass. If you run this through three times without changing this, it will sand all three times. The third time will be very light, and you'll be surprised you get a really nice finish out of that 80 grit paper. If your work is of a nature that you need both sides cleaned up, then alternate sides. Don't get one side perfectly done and then turn to the other side. So alternate, turn it around, get a nice even reduction of the thickness that way, and a good finish in the end. If you've got a lot to take off, you might use the planer again. I would use the planer anytime I could if it was narrow enough to go through it. That would be my first choice. This, I might run it through just for a light finishing, but that planer does a super job. So anyway, if you're sanding away here and you're going on down and you get near the end, don't adjust this anymore. Just run it through a couple more times, you'll get a good finish. Well, one more thing. We talked about running the wood through several times and rotating it and flipping it so it gets a nice uniform reduction. After you've made four or five passes, you should turn it off, lift this lid, and look in here and see what this looks like. Now, this is practically clean. I mean, this is like almost brand new. There's just a little bit of stuff stuck on here. this area right here, which is real hard to see because it's so small, this is the whole thing that will start looking like this. You'll get inch wide areas that look like this. That's blinded. That's not sanding anymore. This guy, the big eraser, can be used. And he will take off any stuff that's loose enough for him to take off, which could be a bunch of it. But you see here, where it got blinded, it's still there. He's not going to take that off. So that's why we don't want to blind the paper. There's no solution other than change it. Some people think they can scrape this off. If you scrape it off, you're scraping the abrasive off at the same time, so you still don't have sandpaper. So that doesn't really work. But this will take off the loose stuff, and you should do this if you see it starting to accumulate under there. So after 4 or 5 passes, take a look at it and clean it if it needs it. Okay? I don't know what else to say about that.
Don't forget to ask your friends.
What am I asking my friend?
In the shop. People that are here.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, if you come down here and you're having trouble with this, most of the guys in the club are willing to help you if they know. Well, some will help you even if they don't know. But most of them will help you if they know. And there's usually a board member or two in the shop pretty often. So check with them and see if they can answer your question or help you with the thing. We want everybody to not abuse the machine and not get injured, of course. But we also want to protect our equipment. Okay. All right.